this is where I go for most of my own games that I've been trying to play. Speaking of which, another game series that I've been trying to get into has been Dragon Quest. Played a fair amount of Dragon Quest V. that's my starting point. I wanted to do Dragon Quest IV as my starting point, but I didn't have a copy of that. Fortunately, one turned up in the game that I used, and I managed to get that one. So, now I have pretty much all physical copies of Dragon Quest. Got Dragon Warrior for the NES. And that's summary. I think I got the that has Dragon Warriors 1 and 2. I don't have any way of playing Dragon Warriors 3 / Dragon Quest. But yeah, the Dragon Warriors series, that's what it's originally called in America here. Even though they've always been Dragon Quest. And they decided to rename it Dragon Warrior for localization reasons. Reasons that don't make any sense, but I just decided to do it anyways. I think it's sell better or even tweak the rhythm or stuff. That's just what they did back in the day. Just makes things confusing now that we're in the internet age. but yeah, I want to eventually finish Dragon Warrior 5. I think about halfway through it. I got the little tiger friend again. I think is probably halfway before the bullet list of the guys that I'm playing. Even though I'm playing them for like the first time, I kind of want to only make a voice on them. Just to kind of, you know, get the experience, get as much expectation as I can. I'm one of those completionists that like custom games. But this one's looking like it's going to be kind of a headache to get completion. It kind of has a Pokemon sort of system where you can be monsters in your party, and there are very few human party members. I'm trying to collect all the monsters, but there's some that, you know, you gotta kill them. At the end of the battle, you have like a 1 in 200 chance to get a few monsters in your party. Like metal slimes, which are common enemies in the Dragon Quest franchise, from what I've heard. But you can actually recruit one in Dragon Quest V. Like, you got 1 in 256 chance to get one Dragon Quest in your party once you can finish them off and down. Granted, battles are actually kind of quick and easy to finish, especially once you bring up their levels a bit. Still, those odds are low, and dragon or metal slimes tend to run away. But, I'm kind of at the point where I'm very close to getting some more party members. If you don't use your monsters, you don't recruit any monsters, then you're just going to be the main character by yourself for a long time. You could be having three other monsters in your party. And I've actually seen on the guide pages that there's actually a challenge around. I don't really think that's that's my idea of monster, but what can you do? I'm actually thinking we get back to the point where some party members start joining me, which is way late to me, like halfway through. Lockers. I hate those things. we're on the Baron floor. I remember setting up like a whole bunch of crap in the corner. Did not manage to find like a star glass or anything on my way up to here. So I don't know what the floor layout is like until I actually get pretty much since I completed my little ward for my cache in the corner. it takes a while for me to beat him around. I think I usually use one blue sand on him or something. I ain't really have the one barometer. Earthquakes decided to throw me up a floor. Yeah, that's kind of where I was at Dragon Quest V. No, I think the topic skip. either way, that's kind of what the vlog is about, right? but yeah, lately I've gotten Dragon Quest IV. I've had, for a little while, I bought a new one. Dragon Quest 6, 7, 8, 9, 11. And I got a bunch of them get to play any of them, but I've been wanting to get into the franchise as a whole, but, you know, 5's been my entry point so far, and about halfway through. There's also all those other games like Rocket Slide, Dragon Quest Monsters, or something like that. Either way, I don't know what those are really about, but I saw them for cheap, so I picked them up. Talking like 10 bucks, 5 bucks. So, that's why you want to shop new. You can get all these games for the price of a sandwich in some places. but yeah, $9 is quite long. I could buy a video game for that price. Anyway, yeah, I've been kind of collecting Craigslist. Actually, I probably want to finish 5 once I actually get back to playing it, because it's been like 5. Once I finish it, I get back into it and all that. I think I'm gonna go back to 4 and finish that. I also got the PS1 version of Dragon Quest 6 that I found happy states. So yeah, I might end up playing that. I might actually play the DS version. I'm not sure which version I'm gonna play. Well, I have both. I gotta collect the games. Gotta collect them all after all. But yeah, I don't know. One other series I've been actually finding copies of nowadays is the Machine Megami Tensei series. Again, kind of going with Persona, since I know that's kind of in the umbrella of everything. Persona that Shinigami Tensei is part of them. But yeah, I managed to get a bunch of the PS2 Shinigami Tensei games lately. So I might play those alongside Persona. I'm not really sure. But I know they're kind of related to part of the same overall franchise. So but yeah, I might eventually play some of those as well. Those are probably gonna go all around. I got a pile of stuff in that corner. always good to use like copper coins once again on the bronze, because copper coins are like usually like $50, I think, gold. I'm probably being a little generous, but get the idea. but yeah, it's just you only get so much from that. They're a good way to just dispose of them while they're wrong. Hopefully get something more valuable. I kind of want to use them. But you can't exactly carry them with the floor, but they are, you know, something that you can pick up on 416. And also, I don't need to hopefully get something better. That was not the earthquake, by the way. I think whatever that was, in fact, you know, it was a troll. That was up ahead. I think it said that was a peaceful trap. So, we're not getting booted out of the floor just yet. Something else I wanted to talk about. I want to switch the topics up a little bit here. I'm actually talking about this first, to be honest, but... but yeah, I wanted to talk about how things have been since my dad passed away. So, still living with mom, mostly because, well, there's not our life situation. She kind of needs me for certain things, and I kind of need her for certain things. We've also got two dogs in the house, so it's kind of my job to take care of them while she's at work. After I get back home from work, because I go over to work over the hill my shift starts, so I usually come home earlier than normal. Take care of dogs. But yeah, that was part of Dad's role when he was still here. He might help him out and stuff. But that's kind of my role now, so that's kind of one of the most interesting things to me. I don't exactly have the best paying job to, have by the whole place going on. But it kind of works out between the two of us, and so we kind of both have things that we do. I highly doubt she's strong enough to she's not exactly evil, but she is, she's not exactly built for the things, she takes one of me, I take care of her, and we both kind of do all the things. So yeah, that's a light situation. Does seem a little bit more quiet than Dad's room. Once again, don't smoke. Well, that's what happens to you. Sometimes you smoke, you die young. You don't even have a chance to enjoy retirement because, but anyways, we're kind of taking advantage of that room now and trying to get stuff. Get some items that are actually worth using or powering us up here. Seeds that I found that you might know. So use those to give him some extra MP. And you can spit up some new. Okay, get in here, one of the last items we get out of him. I think we get anywho, while we exploit the Barong, now let's get back into some other game talk. I know, I'm kind of bouncing from subject to subject. I really had no time in mind what topics I was going to talk about today. What else should I talk about? What have I been playing lately? Might as well talk about that. So lately I've been playing Smash Ultimate, like everybody. I've kind of actually slowing down on that. I've only been out for like a month and a half at this point, but I can safely say I've pretty much done everything almost. I'm still gonna be classic mode on a couple of characters. There's a lot of characters to be with. But I've got the vast majority of all the spirits at this point. I've been in adventure mode a couple times through. Actually beating out normal and easy mode. I'm working on hard. But it takes a long time to reach all the battles that are actually happening. We got to play Smash quite a bit. In Smash, I'm actually pretty much down to the last 80 or so spirits that I have left to collect. So it's kind of like I'm at 1,220 some odd spirits out of 1,302, I believe, is the amount. So I've got almost all of them. I've got about 50 left that I need to summon. And I haven't figured out exactly what the deal is with, some of the alternate spirits. Maybe just gonna be classic ones that I can character again. But lately I've been finding that I like Solar and Fire Emblem. And, well, actually I've also been playing Fire Emblem Facebook. quite a bit in my off time. I haven't actually beaten any of the routes in Fire Emblem Fates. I do have Revelations, I do have Volt Conquest and Vertebrae, but I haven't really gotten past Chapter 15 in any of the stories. I'm pretty sure it's like Awakening when there's probably 5 chapters per route. But I'm mostly focusing on my conquest, and I am over-leveling my crazy. Yes, I do use the DLC stages to over-level the conquest. And, you know, I say, you know what? They gave us this whole relationship system, and the fact that you can get all these children as a result of the relationship system, and how they become units and all that. They use, like, paradox and time stuff, and they use whatever they can to explain how their children can grow in the blink of an eye to fight alongside their parents, even though their parents are technically the same age as them, once they are fully grown, because they use this other realm to grow up. But, the, like, how you have to get your relationship down, and, you know, pair up the units and support levels up. I say if they're going to have that in game like Conquest, they're basically copy-pasting how they did it with Fire Emblem Awakening, I'm going to DLC grind and level up and get the relationships up and get all the children characters and get them from very early stage. Get them from a very early stage in the game and just over-level like crazy. Because that's kind of how I play that game. I like to over-level the Fire Emblem games, because for me, it's more about, you know, leveling up your characters and just breathing through the glory after that. And that's how it is how I play with Fire Emblem. That's kind of also why I haven't actually finished them, because I'm so focused on killing all the child characters and pairing up. It's basically a shipping simulator. if you like to ship anime characters, that's probably a good game for you. I'll put you like strategy. Speaking of strategy RPGs, one other game I've been playing lately has been, it's been out for a long time, but it recently got re-released as Skya 1.8. I've actually played a fair amount on PS1. Never actually beat it again. what is it with me not beating me? But whatever. but the thing is, I hit a brick wall in this guy at 1, like in chapter 12 or something like that. I forget how far I actually was, and it's actually in the save file. But I've gotten Gordon, and I was kind of doing some chapters after. But yeah, I've been playing the Skya 1 complete a little bit on and off, and I gotta say, I really like the Skya games. It's just, they are very grind-heavy, and even with me grinding like crazy Fire Emblem Fates games, this is taking it to like a whole other level. And some of the battle themes are just, well, the music, I don't really care for the items. But yeah, I'm trying to get a bunch of spells and stuff for everyone. I have, like, the main cast, Harl, Floron, all the characters that are given to you in the story. I have them apprentice a bunch of mages, clerics, and all that, and so that way I can teach my main characters all the spells that are available to me. And yeah, I kind of do go a little extra crazy with grinding, even though it is already as monotonous, not monotonous as it is, I make it even more monotonous trying to get like all the spells on all my characters. And that means I gotta level up every mage class to 100 multiple times. but then again, I kind of already know about the residents, and kind of working and building up to get a very strong deck to shoot my residents. forgot that the school is really good right now. So, like, that does allow me to. So, when you have one of those meetings a year, it makes it so that, you need a lot more XP to level, so you can level up faster. And that's going to be a very pivotal point in getting all the spells on that, because I know that's kind of more of a thing for post-game, but I'm at a point in new chapters where I like to stop for a bit, because there's a type of monster in my game. Well, in order for you to summon them, you have to beat them like 30 times. And you gotta play, see what I'm doing, is you gotta play it 30 times through in order to beat that specific monster 30 times, because there's only one that appears in there. I'm probably just rambling on right now. I've kind of realized, caught myself that, kind of rambling on, where unless you've actually played the game, you probably wouldn't know what I'm talking about. I actually do have copies of Skya 2, Skya 3, Skya 4. I'm planning to get to them someday, but eventually I will. Also got D2, Skya 5, and eventually I'll play them all, but I've got to finish the first one first. That's kind of my rule. You gotta finish one before you go on to the next. Why don't we actually talk about Azure Dream here? I'm actually thinking I might actually make another episode of these pretty quick. I'm also thinking I might split this episode and, make two videos out of it. I already know this episode is going to be an hour and 20 minutes. So I'm probably going to split up and post half of it today, which literally recording this Tuesday the 15th. I may actually just finish editing it and post it later today this afternoon sometime. I might post the other half on Thursday. I'm gonna make it split between vlog and town, halfway through the vlog. I'm not sure that roughly 30 to 40 minutes. I have a hard time splitting it because I tend to just babble on like crazy. Kind of how the whole point of a blog post is, right? So, What else do I talk about? Another game I've pretty much completed at this point is Xenoblade Chronicles. Kind of funny, I've completed Xenoblade Chronicles 1 twice. Once for the Wii version, 3DS version. Excuse me, the new 3DS version. Distinction, because play it on normal 3DS, you gotta play it on the beefed up hardware new 3DS. Yeah, I've kind of beaten that on both systems. I'm kind of in my second playthrough right now. About halfway through the game yet again. Got all the party members back. I kind of went around and just doing side quests right now, but I can see that the Corner of the Republic have not actually started playing yet. But because I got the Corner of the Republic game, it also came with the download code for all the DLC and the Xenoblade Chronicles 2. So, I'm actually getting all the special blades that you were able to get on the Team Shop release, the family blades DLC. And because I got the physical copy of Corner of the Republic, it came with the download code for all the DLC from the first game. So that's kind of why I wanted to go with that. I did not actually buy any of the DLC for Xeno, but I got characters like a set, and I don't know if there's any more that I'm missing at this point in time, but I know, like, characters from Xenoblade Chronicles 1 return as Blaze, and you have to get them through some kind of special means. I think the system, I'm not that sure. I'm actually found how to get that. I think I'm at the point where I'm actually supposed to be able to get that, but I haven't actually got it. But, like, the main hero of this Xenoblade Chronicles 1 Shulk comes back as a blade, I guess. I haven't actually heard it, but he does have a silhouette on my menu of the list of all the blades that you get. So I'm assuming it's him. Also, I think Elmo from Xenoblade Chronicles X comes in. Mostly just token characters that you get as you go through, but, you know, kind of how the blade system works is the blades are actually characters who give you their weapon. Honestly, I still don't get why that's a thing. All the blade characters, they're like spirits or something like that, that inhabit a weapon. I don't get why they didn't just make them actual party members, because it's just kind of goofy seeing them fight in battle. They disconnect your character with like some magic line. And it's like, you pass your weapon off to them whenever you do a special move. Like, couldn't you just have it so that it's like in the cutscenes where they have, like, instead of just having the main character do all the fighting for the most part, then you bust out your special move and pass the blade over to your actual blade, the weapon to your blade. I'm afraid to get my door open now, right? But kind of like, why don't you just have them attack by themselves? It's kind of weird. And I don't get it, but that's kind of how the lore of the story goes. It's some weird lore, story and all that, but anyway. It's just one of those things where it would have been much more sense to just make them characters or something. Beyond that, yeah, I've been playing Xenoblade Chronicles 2 for like the second time through, I think. I got as much done as I possibly could, I think, in my first playthrough. But then there's a bunch of new plus content that you only do once you beat the game. So I kind of did that. I had fun. There's a character that you get, like, in one of the early chapters that you only get for that particular chapter, but I actually took him around and leveled him up super high, like he's not actually supposed to be, but yeah, I thought that was just kind of fun that you could actually go crazy with that. it was just something I did. Anyways, a bunch of stuff I've been doing is really crazy too. What else? I don't know. I'm kind of looking over at my game shelf right now to see if I've got any other topics to talk about. I've got my things to say. Now, what else? Something I've been collecting lately is I've been actually getting a decent amount of stitches. And one thing I found a bit surprising about the Switch, well, I don't know if I would actually say surprising, but I'm actually kind of glad that Nintendo is getting their act together with the Switch. Lately I've been noticing a trend with Switch gaming that Nintendo has actually been getting a lot of the games they should have had for the Wii U. And what I'm saying that is the Switch has become something of a port machine. Plus, it's also getting a lot of new releases as well. So, I did say, like, Skya 1, I was pointing to that on the Switch lately. That's actually just pretty much a remastered version of the original. They didn't really add a ton to it, but they actually did add, you know, they changed a lot of the sprites to something, give it more current and all that. I mean, one of the biggest changes I've noticed is, like, the skull job class. used to be just, like, some ugly-looking dudes, and then they changed them to, like, you know, girly boys. By the way, yeah, this guy tends to be kind of just one of those games where it's like, it's good to be a deviant kind of deal. So, like, one of the main characters, she totally wears, like, fetish gear and all that. But, I don't know, it's just kind of, that's kind of how things are with, software games. Because they tend to play on, like, a lot of the anime, eye candy and all that, but it's typically good for but yeah, it's just kind of like, there's that, they got Skya, they got the Skya games on their system. They got like Skyrim 10 years late. What other games do I have that they got late? I think Dragon Quest Builders was originally on the PS3. I got that in the collection, and now they finally got it. Owlboy was originally on Steam. They got a physical copy on Switch. Cave Story eventually came to Switch. There's a few other games I've got. SIMSteven, Lacrimosa Madonna. That was originally on the 4, I think. And then they eventually got that later. God Wars, Strategy RPG, another game that was originally on PlayStation, probably 3 or 4. But yeah, they've been getting a lot of games. They've been kind of expanding, and they've realized, you know, game consoles are about the games, and that's one thing I like about Nintendo as of late, is that they've just been getting a lot of games in general. And, well, you know, the collector in me has got to have as many as he can get. At least the ones he wants to play. I don't exactly collect games I don't want to play. Especially like sports games. Keep away. You'll probably never see me own a copy of FIFA or Madden or anything like that. Just because they're games I don't want to play. I don't like sports games. But I might buy the occasional racing. In fact, I heard something about Crash Team Racing. I don't know what system that's going to be on. But I did play Crash Team Racing on PS1 a ton back in the day. I don't exactly know if it's going to be on the Switch or the PlayStation. And screw if it's even going to be on the Xbox either. But I am excited actually for Pokemon Xperia on the Switch. I actually got that on my list that of games I want to buy this year. As well as, well, did back Bloodstain, so eventually I'll be getting that whenever they eventually finally release that. They actually did their Kickstarter back around the time that IE number 9 was coming out, and they still have yet to release the game. I did actually play the 8-bit game that they released last year. Play it through once, it was kind of fun for a little while. very Castlevania 3-ish. But yeah, I didn't just mention Tales of Suspiria. I have not played a Tales game. I've kind of been wanting to get Tales of Destiny 1 and 2 for PlayStation 1, but those games are super rare as well. I was like, I want to start from the beginning if I possibly can. If not, I'll start from Symphonia. I think Symphonia is the next one that we got in the States. I think Fantasia was like the next one in the series after Destiny, and I think I got it on like the Gameplay Advance. I don't know if I'm actually going to start with that in the franchise, but I might do Tales of Symphonia. I heard it's a really good game though, so take a ton of my time if I actually get into the Tales of games, so I kind of got to prepare for that. If I actually get into Tales games, but I do definitely want to get into Suspiria because Suspiria is the only game, quite literally, it's been the only game on my list that's been an Xbox exclusive. Out of all the Xbox games, 360s, Xbox One, I mean, Suspiria is the only one I actually cared about, and it's the only one that didn't come off the Xbox. Now it's finally coming to Switch, and I can say, you know what, screw the Xbox, I never cared about you, you're all about the first person shooters, with the only games that I care about that are first-person shooters these days, are the Metroid Prime games, and that's a Nintendo exclusive, so through all that noise, I don't really care if the Xbox. I really am. And the Xbox is also mostly sports games and stuff like FIFA and all that crap. And I never really care as much about the Xbox. It's just the game I am right now, so. And I don't even know how I got on this tangent. How did I get on this tangent? But either way, yeah. But yeah, what was I talking about? I just like how the Switch has been getting lots and lots of games of late. And, you know, that's just kind of, it makes me happy because I grew up on Nintendo and all that. Oh, and yeah, there I go, crack an egg. I use Truth Glass on it. But yeah, they've also just gotten a lot of games they should have had on the Wii U. For example, I listed off Skyrim. They got it 10 years late or something like that. But I got into Skyrim 10 years late. actually more like 9 years late. I got the PC version like a year before it came out on the Switch. But then I didn't start playing it on the Switch. But yeah, lots of games coming on the Switch. And it's like, Nintendo is playing catch-up, but at the same time, they're also getting new releases, so it's just games. Hopefully, that'll make things better for them, because Nintendo is definitely a company I want to see do well. Sony as well, screw Microsoft and their Xbox, I don't really care about them. And if any console were to leave the market, like Sega did back in the day, I'd like to see the Xbox just... I'd like to see it tank, because I'd rather have the competition between Sony and Nintendo, because Xbox just kind of... They kind of have their, you know, they kind of have their plan going with all these, you know, online games, and shooter games, and games with lots of DLC and add-ons and all that, and that's kind of their business model. But honestly, I'm not too thrilled with how they're doing. The fact that they don't really care about the RPG market, like hardly at all. And I am very big into RPG gaming. I also kind of like a lot of the anime games that are out there, stuff by like Heart. There's a few games I've been trying to get into that I just haven't had enough time to play. But yeah, SquareSoft games as well. I've always been a Square fan. One of these days I'll actually play Final Fantasy 15. I've actually seen people play it on YouTube, and I kind of got a good grasp of what the game's all about, and the story and everything, but I do definitely want to play it for myself one time, but not had time to get around to it. With me playing games like Xenoblade Chronicles and Skyrim, I don't really have time for another huge, massive RPG. In fact, speaking of which, I kind of want to get into Monster Hunter someday. I actually have Monster Hunter on the PS2, the original, and due to shoddy localization practices, they didn't release any Monster Hunter games in the US for a while. So, like, Monster Hunter 2, I think, is, like, a Japan exclusive. Actually, I like to play through that as well, but, so hopefully they actually port it to the US, or localize it or something. But, like, when Monster Hunter World came out, it was a big deal. And, I want to play that as well. and I'd also like to play through some of the games like, there's a 3DS Monster Hunter World game as well, like Stories or something like that. And honestly, a big part of what's got me interested in Monster Hunter has been, Nintendo itself. They've got Reshiram or whatever his name is, the big dragon thing in the boss in Smash Brothers. They've got a couple of amiibos. I actually got one of them as an import for Christmas. Not last year, but for Christmas of 2017. We actually found a site that was selling it pretty cheap, and I sent, sent an email saying, hey, buy this, and see if you can get it for me for Christmas. And my sister, well, she did. She got me one of the Monster Hunter Amiibos that was the Japan import. And considering it's not, you know, region-wide or anything, I'll use it on games. I've actually used it in the Animal Crossing game and made a Monster Hunter room in New Leaf. But yeah, kind of want to get into Monster Hunter at some point in time if I permit it and all that. But, yeah, just another game I've been wanting to play. One game I have been playing has been, well, I can thank Nintendo for Three Sun because he started playing this on his channel for a little bit and he got me hooked on a game called Don't Starve. I got the download, I downloaded the version that's on Switch. I don't know if it's got any DLC on it, but I do believe it has Ring of Giants Direct DLC pack. I don't know if I've got all the characters, however. I could have sworn that there were supposed to be more characters out there, but, yeah, I've just kind of been playing with some of the more vanilla characters lately. I've got a good base going in Don't Starve with, I believe my, her character's name is Wendy. I mean, it's not exactly listed anywhere in the game's UI while you're playing it, so I think her name is Wendy, but I've been playing using her. Also, I just realized our tower run has ended. So we're selling our crap. Looks like we're gonna cut things off a little bit early. But yeah, Don't Starve has been a pretty fun game. I've got a pretty good map going. Got my base in a really good location. I actually did eventually, once I got this map going, I actually decided, you know, this is a good map. I'm gonna run around it and go everywhere and find all the stuff before I actually go there. And then soft reset! And then just reload and stay on that map and all that. but yeah, I just kind of know where everything is, and I've got a really good setup going on this map. anyways, Nico is waking us up. We've already seen her little thing before, where she wakes us up. And she's trying to be a bit more girly, even though she's the tomboy. She's trying to cut that habit of being a tomboy. Saw her story, so I don't need to explain it. Anyways, I guess while I was going through here, I decided to set up all my monsters, and when I was playing through at this point, I actually came up with, on the fly, for what I think is actually a pretty appropriate name for a Kraken. Also, we're going to fuse my dreams next time around. But I eventually came up with a name for my Kraken as I was going through making my hut here. Just kind of as I'm about ready to close out the episode here. I'm actually going to name my Kraken Marina. I'm actually a pretty big Splatoon fan. So, actually I've kind of been slowing down on Splatoon lately. But Marina is one of the characters from Off the Hook from Splatoon 2. And, well, Kraken, in most games at least, is typically going to be like an octopus of some sort. So, you know, octopus, Kraken, Marina is an octoling. so why not name my Kraken after Marina? And I'm going to say that my Kraken is a female. I know monsters in this game are actually genderless. But I actually came up with on the fly a name for my Kraken. So I'll give it a name. Also, now that I'm speaking about naming my characters, I was actually thinking about what I was going to name my Nanoeva, because, let's be honest, I don't know a whole lot of slime characters in video games that are kind of noteworthy. I mean, I've been playing Dragon Quest games, Dragon Quest V lately, and slimes are like the default Goomba type enemy. But I haven't actually found any, you know, generic or noteworthy slime enemies or characters in the Dragon Quest games. But either way, I was actually thinking about a name for my Mana Lab on lately. It's also kind of why I want to do another episode pretty soon. Just so I can actually show it off, but I'm thinking of naming my Mana Lab, my slime thing, Tartar. Because in Splatoon 2, if you get the Octoling expansion, there's actually a slime character who's actually named Tartar. So, and he's just kind of an abomination. He actually fuses with things, but that might be the name for what I give him. Anywho, we're at the end of the episode, and I'm saving here, so that's it. Thanks for watching. I am SIMSteven, also known as Mr. Funeral. See you next time.